So your first album was a hit. It sold well, it reviewed well, you hit it out of the park on your very first try. Do it again. If only it were that easy. Join me, Austin Scholl, on Sophomore Slumps, where we take a look at music's most disappointing follow-ups. From Second Coming to October to Fairweather Johnson, we'll give a second chance to the albums from artists who fumbled theirs. Listen in on the Zero Science Network and wherever podcasts may be found.
Mr. Too Dope, perhaps you would care to read for the ladies and gentlemen of the jury the lyrics from your popular song, Blacken Your Eyes.
Filled your head with lead because I want you dead. Girly, girly bitch, you freaky, freaky bitch.
That's deplorable. Your songs drove my client's roommate to kill himself. Would that be an accurate statement?
Allow me to interject, please. We at Insane Clown Posse are very, very active in the community. We work with a number of local charities.
Yeah, like we read to dead people.
We also spit fire.
No further questions.
Everybody, welcome to another episode of Jukebox Zeroes, where your idols come to die, and I can't imagine anyone's going to be at the door this time.
Hello?
What? Who said that? Who's there?
Can I come in? Hello?
Who are you?
Excuse me, this is, I was wondering if I could speak to Mr. Patrick Barry, if he was available at this time.
He was here a second ago. I'm not sure where he disappeared off to. I think he said something about going pooping.
Going pooping. Interesting. Interesting. All right. Well,
It's not that interesting.
Well, I find a lot of things very, very interesting about all sorts of things. But namely one Mr. Patrick Barry, but also the young Pinkerton who done come around here, investigating the case for that Father Alexander case. You see, I find Detective Steinberg's interest in Father Alexander to be a bit curious, is maybe a word for... You know, let me introduce myself. My parents done gave me the name of Eugene Deuteronomy Applebaum way back in the day, but you could just call me Sir. you can call me Gene. And who do I have the pleasure of speaking with this evening?
Well, my name is Lilz. You really think Officer Steinberg is young? Or Detective Steinberg? He seemed pretty old to me.
Well, maybe it's just I'm a bit long in the tooth myself.
Like late 50s or so.
Yeah, I'm nearly 100, but, you know, I get by. Well, you know, I see that you're in the middle of something here. I'm going to pop back in next week. You know, I got plenty of time. I got all season to figure out this.
Okay. It's not my house, but okay.
Well, I'm just going to leave my card right here. And, you know, if you happen to see Mr. Barry, why don't you send him my way? I have a few questions about his good friend, Mr. Steinberg, who I believe was the last one that he spoke with. When you did your Jukebox Zeroes program last weekend.
You know an awful lot about what's going on here, in spite of asking, like, what's going on here.
Yeah, I like to do a bit of a two-step verification, if you will. But I have my birds who come around and take a look at the happenings around the creek in Aya, Massachusetts, the old factory. Where you find folks through your Jukebox Zeroes program, which I'm a big fan of. I like a few controversial records myself. Have you heard of one called Elvis Goes Live?
Okay, I think you need to leave, please.
I think I do. Well, yes, have a good night.
Please go away. Okay, so that happened. Hey, Pat, You want to explain why you just went and immediately hid in the broom? You want to just immediately explain why you went and hid in the coat closet when that guy came in?
No, I do not.
I thought you said
he's weird, huh? He's really weird. I don't want to talk about it.
I thought you said last week everything was like all okay now. Everything had been dealt with.
Yeah. I think it is done. I don't know what this guy's problem is. He's weird, though, huh? Why don't we move on? Why don't we just stop talking about the guy that you're just talking to? Who fucking cares? He's old news. Dumb. It's all set.
Right. Right.
It's all set.
Okay, before we get, I guess we do this first now. We got to introduce our guest as part of our special crossover month with Old Men Yell at Cloud.
That's right.
The famous third member of Old Men Yell at Cloud. I am, of course, talking of Jeremy Dave. Why don't you come on in here, Jeremy Dave?
Hey, everybody, it's me, Jeremy Dave. That's Jeremy Dave time. All right, everybody, it's Jeremy Dave.
There's that Jeremy Dave that we know and love.
Yeah, love him. He's from parts unknown.
Okay, I got to go now. What, you just got here, Jeremy Dave. Goodbye.
Oh, and also Jim Schultz is here.
Hold down.
Please refer to me as the Great Milenko for the rest of the show.
I will do no such thing. That is a title that has to be earned.
I am the Great Milenko. I will wave my magic wand and make all the Fago appear.
That you actually did. Okay, that Jim actually was able to accomplish because I went out to the old porch stoop this morning to go get my packages and opened up a fresh bottle of Fago Red Pop, which I have never tasted before.
Neither have I. I'm a little scared.
I have not as well, and as a matter of fact, I too was the recipient of a bottle of Fago Red Pop.
Oh, yes.
Which might give you a clue about what we're talking about today if Jim calling himself the Great Milenko didn't immediately give it away. So before we get into the album we're talking about this week, why don't we hit up the apology section super quick?
Sure.
Yeah, listen. We fucked up.
I'm going to apologize for last week, because listening back to it, it's a wonder that, all three of us were still awake at all.
I disagree.
I mean, it was still a very enjoyable episode, but we were, almost dead.
I was pretty sleepy, and truth be told, I'm at about, 70% today, because this is the day after Thanksgiving. And
yeah, I'm pretty tired today.
We did a lot of eating and drinking and smoking and whatever else one does.
I mean, the last time, though, there really wasn't any excuse except to say that I think it was just one of those days.
I think it was, yeah. I was just feeling dumpy. It was like that time daylight saving shift thing and just catching up on that daylight. Yeah.
Yeah, it got dark at 4:30 today. It was bullshit.
Oh, yeah, it was rough. I was in bed by, 8 o'clock yesterday.
Oh, boy.
I'm going to apologize for all the legal scuffles that I seem... Or not legal. Just regular scuffles. I'm going to apologize for all the sort of scuffles that seem to be happening at the beginning of the program.
Okay, you definitely said legal scuffles, though.
No, I didn't. I said beagle.
Okay, I'm not sure if... Okay. Oh, yes, and I can't forget our Season 4 taglines. Welcome to Season 4. We're stupid jerks now. A trench full of urine. I'm so mad at all five of my dads. Straight from the duck. Please. It's Dumpsterton.
Wow. Racking up quite a collection there.
I'm going to apologize for getting Red Pop Fago instead of the classic orange because I couldn't find it.
I wasn't sure if mine was going to arrive in time, so I spent a couple... an hour or two just sort of wandering around random Family Dollars in my area because I swear I've seen these there before.
I just looked on because when I typed Fago into Google, it immediately showed me where I could get it. Apparently, they sell it at Walmart, which is not surprising.
Yeah, I'm not going into Walmart. That's not a thing that I intend to do.
See, I thought Red Pop was kind of their signature flavor.
It might be.
But then... It is strawberry. Okay. See, I thought it was kind of along the same lines as like Big Red, which I thought was like cherry flavored. But I don't know what the fuck I'm talking about. These like weird landlocked sodas that I'm not aware of.
Yeah, that's kind of a bit more of a relief for me because I hate the taste of cherry flavoring.
It's terrible. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like drinking Robitussin.
Yeah, not that I have terribly high hopes for this, but...
you guys know, though, in 2009, Faygo won a Best Root Beer.
Really?
If you're a root beer fanatic. Mm.
I do love root beer.
Well, apparently in 2009, they won Best Root Beer, so...
This has been another edition of Jim's Fun Facts.
Yay!
Play the theme song.
Fun facts with Old Man Yell at Clown. I don't want to have it.
Faygo celebrates 100th birthday from the Detroit News. 2008. I don't know. That's the article I found.
Well, actually, they for the 100th anniversary, they opened up a flavor contest. And a fourth grade Ohio teacher... came up with Centennial Soda.
What was the taste of that?
No idea. I think it probably tasted like a 100-year-old newspaper, I'm guessing.
I was going to say 100-year-old egg.
Wow. Faygo is 100 years old. Wow.
Well, it's 113 now.
Oh yeah, that's
true. As of our year 2020.
I can only imagine like the founder, Horatio Torquemada Faygo, or whatever his name is.
Ben and Perry Fagenson.
Just very, very upset going, "You're doing it with the soda! That's not what I intended!"
Imagine.
Please stop spraying it!
I hope he got to go to an Insane Clown Posse show before he died.
Oops, we just revealed what we're talking about today.
Yeah, well, I already did that.
Yeah, that's true. So I'll just make my essay super quick then.
You mean we're not doing Pink Floyd's The Great Milenko?
So in the whole of music history, few acts have inspired such intense amounts of both exaltation and derision, quite like Insane Clown Posse. The duo of Violent J and Shaggy 2 Dope, born Joseph Bruce and Joseph Utzler respectively, are considered pioneers of the hip-hop subgenre of horrorcore rap music. Setting themselves apart from the gangster-centric rap of the 90s, with lyrics inspired by elements of horror and the supernatural, as well as circus iconography. Famously, the two would paint their faces with macabre clown makeup to really drive home the circus motif. Often these songs would be inspired by their low-income upbringings in Detroit, Michigan. Across 15 full-length albums from 1992 to 2019, Insane Clown Posse were not especially successful in a contemporary sense, often being an object of mockery and ridicule from music critics, who are often unimpressed with the duo's blend of horror-inflected acid rap and rap rock. In spite of this, however, they maintain a veritable legion of dedicated fans, famously referred to by the moniker of Juggalos.
Whoop whoop!
Yes, Jim, of course, the foremost expert on Insane Clown Posse in our area.
No.
Geography.
I just like to get drunk and listen to Fuck the World.
Who doesn't?
This intensely devoted cult fan base would not only generate impressive sales for the independent act, but translate to mega-selling live shows and tours, including their famed annual festival, The Gathering of the Juggalos, which have attracted hundreds of thousands of attendees and, in addition to ICP, have also featured lineup appearances by legendary acts like Gwar, 3-6 Mafia, George Clinton and Parliament, and various members of Wu-Tang Clan, among others. And also POD.
For good measure. Yeah. That'll round out the...
Well, ICP is a Christian band, and so is POD, so yes. I mean, it makes sense.
It's so everyone can feel so alive for the very first time.
Yeah, 3-6 Mafia is Pentecostal.
Mm. And yet, in spite of the massive success, Insane Clown Posse is still looked upon often mockingly for various reasons ranging from the sheer silliness of the clown gimmick, their supposedly unserious and unintellectual lyrics, or the sheer overexcitement to their fan base. We're not really sure where we stand on the matter personally, but the sheer scope of divisiveness around the group has really left us no choice but to weigh in. Make no mistake, however, we don't intend to immediately bury Insane Clown Posse. We come to attempt to understand them, and to hopefully get as top-tier an experience as possible to fairly assess this controversial music group. So we're going to be taking a deep dive into the record often considered one of the greatest by their fans. and is undoubtedly one of the albums that put the duo on the map in a mainstream sense. Their fourth record, 1997's The Great Milenko.
So it's funny because...
hey, they named it after you, Jim.
I am The Great Milenko. A friend of mine was a juggalo. He owned it. Eric, he's been on Old Men Yell At Lilz. He was on for the Opeth episode. And I messaged him and I said... I said something like, oh, I'm doing a podcast and we're doing The Great Milenko. And he's like, it's good. I was like, all right. So,
yes, Eric, it's very good.
Oh, yeah. I said, I have to listen to The Great Milenko for a podcast. And he said, it's good, exclamation point. Then he said, can you put Planes, Trains, and Automobiles in the last season of Curb Your Enthusiasm on Plex?
Sure,
but
buddy.
What on earth does that have to do with The Great Milenko?
He wanted me to wave my magic wand and get that shit up on Plex.
So we might as well get this out of the way before we start digging into the tracks. As we mentioned at the top, Jim bought us all Fagos, and much like the famed anecdote of the former lead singer of Mayhem keeping a dead crow under his bed so that he could sniff it and have the scent of death in his nostrils before going on stage, we are going to take a sip of this Fago.
Nom, 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 nom. Ready? Here we go.
And have the essence of Juggalos in our veins. Just going to open mine near the microphone. Ooh.
It's very, very compressed.
Yeah, that's a pop.
Wow.
Well, it is a red pop.
Oh, no. Immediately, this smells like cough syrup.
Yeah, it does.
All right. Well,
cheers.
Here we go.
Oh, it's awful.
Ugh.
Nope.
Oh, this is foul.
I don't hate it.
That
bit too sweet.
This literally tastes like cough syrup.
Strawberry cough syrup. Yeah, it's a bit too cloying for me.
Oh, it's bad.
We tried. Sorry, guys. I tried to understand the culture, but I think I just...
Oh, boy.
I'm ethnocentric in this way.
Going back to your informational tidbits there, I also read on the Wikipedia that this was originally going to get released on Disney.
Oh,
through
yes,
Hollywood Records.
Yeah, we'll definitely have some things to say about that as we move forward.
But it didn't fit with their family. Whatever. Yeah, we'll get to it.
Well, yeah, it was. They signed a contract with Hollywood Records label. Yeah, which we'll get into that.
Yeah. All right. Let's get things started off with the first track. Track number one, titled Intro.
Six will visit, followed by the crumbling of time itself. Before the coming of Shangri-La, a dark carnival will sweep across the land as a shadow, plagued with destruction. A parade of freaks, jugglers, and death.
Hello, Alice Cooper.
There he is.
Yep.
Coopering away. So here's a fun fact.
Is that really him?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's legit Alice Cooper. He read the intro right there.
Oh, no shit.
So that was an intro track.
Yes, it was.
Yeah. Not much more to be said about that.
I noticed a theme throughout the record where they kind of poke fun at the rednecks a bit.
Yeah, they're no fun. They're no fan of rednecks. I'm not really sure how that, you know, comes to grip with the whole sort of like we're proud of being low class sort of thing that seems to be a recurring theme throughout Insane Clown Posse's music. But I don't know.
I found it mildly entertaining and. Maybe it's just because I was rewatching True Blood with Gina recently, but it's just the sort of trashy horror South theme. I was getting a kick out of it. Also, I'm a little crispy right now. But yeah, it's funny to hear Alice Cooper sign on to a project. I didn't think ICP really had enough clout at this point.
Oh, I'm sure it was all like a result of the record label they were working with.
Probably.
All right, so immediately moving on from that, we're moving on to track two.
My song.
Yes, Jim's song.
Here we go.
Jim's lovely theme song, Great Milenko.
Hee hee hee, ha ha ha.
So this is another intro track. Because the first one didn't quite take, I guess.
No, I feel like this was like a thing in the 90s for a while with certain goth horror-ish adjacent records where there were like a few opening tracks in a row. One that stuck out in my head that we listened to recently was October Rust from Typo Negative. There's like two or three like intro tracks that happen before like the first proper song happens. Yeah, I think it's just, you know, making use of the like the CD 80-minute format and the sprawl, so to speak.
How is that acceptable? That just feels like so much filler to me.
It does, but I think like the demographic of people that purchase this stuff are like also there for the skits and like the story. So, I mean, I guess it's important in building a story. We have a sort of Great Milenko.
Oh, yes. The Prairie Home Companion-esque anecdotes that you find here on Great Milenko. I was being a little facetious. This isn't quite an intro track because it also gives us our first taste of the sounds of ICP members Violent J and Shaggy 2 Dope.
It also not so gives much the introduction to the dark carnival.
Oh, yes. They're not so much they're not so much rapping as carnival barking, like, because there's a carnival happening. Did you miss that part?
Yeah.
Because you're going to be reminded of it a lot.
Spooky carnival.
Yeah, I'd feel cheap if I didn't play a clip with the two rappers actually on it and not just the beat. So here's a clip I've cobbled together from two separate parts, just so you get an idea for both. Let's go for it. Let's meet the dudes.
Come on, come on.
Necromancy.
I feel like I'm at Spooky World.
Man, I feel like I'm back in high school, really not enjoying having to listen to this. But now that years later, the nostalgia is actually it was fun to hear this song again after not hearing it for like 20 years.
Yeah. There we go. There's our guys that we're going to be spending the whole of nearly 70 minutes with.
I love them. They're my friends.
My pals. They're good.
If you weren't sure which was which moving forward, just remember, Violent J was the first guy. He's the one who sounds like an angry white rapper. And Shaggy 2 Dope is the one that sounds like a cartoon mouse.
That's right. That's a good way to differentiate.
I have no idea what to tell you. That's all I could think of whenever he opened his mouth. Every time Shaggy 2 Dope Esquire would speak, I just picture like a bunch of cartoon mice, except they're also mobsters. Like, come on, come on. He's
also,
doing what?
Violent J is also Steve Harwell. He's also Guy Fieri.
Yes, of course.
He's been a lot of things.
Sammy Hagar.
Wow, he got pulled into that ring too.
Yeah, it's like a Tony Clifton situation where multiple people play Violent J.
Never seen him in the same spot.
See, I was about to guess he was a Highlander.
Oh yeah, so he lives forever. He is forever.
Yeah, we'll never know for sure until someone tries to cut his head off.
Born to be kings, we're the somethings of the universe. Princes of the universe? Yeah. Oh, man. How did I forget that?
Yeah. All right. enough preamble. Enough prelude. Let's get to an actual track proper.
Yeah, let's
Here's track number three, titled Hocus Pocus with K's.
What am I doing with my life?
I'm glad you had the Faygo clip in there because I made it a point to count how many times Faygo was referenced throughout this album. That was the first one.
Do you have a final tally for us when we get to the end?
Yes, I do.
So this one is sort of like you get a little bit of all of the ICP lore. You get your circus references. You get your
you get the little circus motif in there.
You get circus You get your ha 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 like rhythmic laughter. You get
you get mass murder.
You get lots of fuck yous. You get fat girl reference. You get Fago reference.
Come take a spin on the carny ride.
Yeah,
you get references to your mom.
Oh, I believe there's a a stab at Eminem on this track as well. Because
really?
I know there's
I didn't think they had met by that point yet.
Oh, I don't know.
There is a story surrounding that, but I didn't think that they had met yet.
They were in the same but they were both fucking around in Detroit. I think they knew of each other.
I think
the beef went back pretty far. I'm not terribly familiar with it, but I know
because
it was,
he
like,
says
in his career.
He says, "I'll call you by your real name, Thick Anus," which I think he's talking about Slim Shady. I think. I could be wrong.
Anus, that's right. I forgot about that.
I'm not so sure because they really enjoy using the word anus on this album.
And nuts. They don't like balls or testicles. They're all about the nuts.
He's nuts.
Pretty much.
Yeah, that's a 90s thing. Yeah. Nuts. Nards.
This track was the third song off The Great Milenko to be released as a single and one of the only ones to chart anywhere, reaching number 53 on the UK singles charts in 1977.
Wow.
In 1997.
They've been
got
around
beat
a while.
Up by Fleetwood Mac. Yes. and then, yeah, you get your motif that Jim was talking about. You also get hit, you get your fuck yous that, like, they really just love saying fuck you.
Oh, yeah.
Because they're 13. And mm-hmm.
They're sticking it to the man. Yeah. They're sticking it to the man.
And it just makes them so happy they have to laugh about it.
Yeah.
So, two Fago references in this track. There's the trunk full of Fago. And then there's also telling somebody to dive into a glass, try to land in a glass of Fago. And then they miss and snap their neck.
That's not going to work.
Okay.
I thought that was a good idea.
So this is just a word of warning for much of the rest of the ep, on my part at least. This episode is not going to be especially heavy on, like, really deep-reaching critique because, well, you heard that clip. You heard the clip.
Now, see, I'm here to observe, like, anthropologically the Juggalo Collective, like, from veranda. So I'm here to, like, listen to the music and sort of just take in the rhythms. I'm not really paying so much attention to the lyrics.
what I'm getting at is, like, the inherent problem I've had listening to this record as many times as I have in preparation for this episode, there's something kind of inescapable with ICP's particular blend of horrorcore rap that just about everything is just completely obvious and on the surface. Like, there's no deeper metatextual metaphors at work when they say
they try to, though.
When they say things like walked into a gypsy's tent with a food stamp and walked out with a magical lamp. Yeah, I met Malenko. He gave me three wishes. That night, I fucked three fat bitches.
Yeah, Patrick's like, watching from the VIP section where it's safe. He's at the gathering. He's watching the gathering unfold from a luxury box at Gillette Stadium. Not that they would do the gathering at Gillette Stadium, but hypothetically,
That's very far from the gathering because those are usually in the Midwest.
Yeah,
behind very thick glass, definitely
with a lab coat on and a clipboard.
Yeah.
You got your own wet bar. They provided some nice cocktail peanuts. There's
no
a make your own. There's a make your own fajita station. It's nice.
Yeah.
Anyway, but everything is exactly as it says on the tin, with very little variation from track to track. Like, I feel like almost every single track can be boiled down to they're working class Detroiters. They like cheap soda. They do horror in the most surface-level carnival spook house kind of way, and if that doesn't connect to you, there's very little that can be helped.
So this track and the one before it features guest vocals from a Gorgon Girls.
Is that a Zelda?
That's a different group.
You're gone, baby. Gone.
Yep.
Gore Girls, a all-female garage band from Detroit. So you got Amy Gore and the other one, Debagoli, both doing some things.
Yeah, they make a lot of appearances throughout the album. I think they're kind of like the go-to for female vocal hooks for most of the songs on here.
Yeah, like in the Boogie Woogie song.
Yeah. But anyway, is this any good, though? Honestly, I have no idea. Like, on its surface, it's clearly not good by any sort of critical standard, but at the same time, the focus and dedication to their premise here is kind of admirable.
And, like, I don't know, the beats and, like, instrumentals themselves are, like, they're fun and stupid, but, like, I don't know, all the drum stuff is, like, actually pretty, like, well-produced and punchy, and, like, it sounds like 90s.
Yeah,
like thick, muscular beats that you would get, like, from that era.
Yeah, the production is very on point.
Yeah, I mean, I like the music. I'm not going to lie, I like some of the lyrics, as stupid as they are, because they gave me a laugh.
That's all you can hope for in these trying times.
I mean, I didn't take it seriously, and I didn't try to fucking make it my way of life like some people do, but, you know,
it's like, this is what we got. What do you want from us?
This is it. Like, Jim, at the age of 33, 34, like, just, sorry, Emily, I got to break off the engagement and join the guild.
I got to be a juggalo.
Got to be a juggalo. Whoop, whoop. Whoop. Got to follow my heart.
I need to go down to my local Home Depot and buy a hatchet. Heart.
I would never forgive myself for subjecting you to this record and changing the course of your life henceforth.
I need to go move out to the Midwest, put my hair into weird little spidery white guy dreadlocks, go buy a hatchet, and deck myself out in whiteface.
Well, it's funny. I sent that picture of me with the Instagram filter on to one of my friend group chats, and I went, guys, I've decided I want to be a juggalo, and one of them just said, Jesus fucking Christ.
I've kept this inside long enough. I will not be stifled.
You people have stood in my way long enough. I'm going to clown college.
What's the matter, homie?
I think I'll have some wine. All right, let's move on to track number 4. This one titled Pinkie Pie. Immediate flashback to our new metal episode a couple episodes ago.
I mean, take out the lyrics, so that's Down City Armory right there. I was into that.
Oh, God. Oh, no.
I'm just kidding, Todd.
I was going to say, it's like that's like their punk rock song right there.
Yeah, you get the Sex Pistols dude, Steve Jones, doing guitar work on that one, which Violent J allegedly... knew very little about the Sex Pistols and declined to show up at the studio when Steve Jones was there that day. It's like, no, just like, you know, punk rock legend. Bleh, fuck you. I got to go eat some ice cream.
And drink some Faygo.
Yeah.
Wonder if there's Faygo ice cream. I could have the best of both worlds.
I could make some. You know, they have ice cream machines.
Won't go to McDonald's. It's always broken there.
So, songs about cop murder are kind of old hat for hip-hop music, but I can't imagine there's many of those involving an axe being driven into people's heads. Like, and it goes a step further by also taking out a corrupt judge and someone of wealth who's like a sheriff or a local politician. It wasn't especially clear.
So, it was, there are the three piggies. One of them was a, like, incest-prone redneck. The other one was a wealthy person, and then... what was the second one?
One of them was
a corrupt cop or something like that.
No, it was a judge.
All right,
whatever. They don't like they're very specific about not liking judges on a lot of tracks on this record. So this track was released as the fourth single off the album, didn't manage to chart, but became notable for the level of censorship applied to it by their label Hollywood Records, a record label owned by Disney, who insisted entire passages be removed or replaced by less graphic lyrics about cop murder.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, go ahead and keep the cop murder, but does he have to say nuts?
Yeah, I was reading the blurb on Wikipedia there. It's like, this one somehow slipped by the folks of Disney.
Yeah, let's go ahead and talk about all that right now. So this album ran into a lot of label-related trouble, speaking of Hollywood Records. Originally, ICP were affiliated with Battery Record, a subsidiary of Jive, but the album released through Jive, 1995's Riddlebox, failed to move units due to poor promotion from the label. Their manager managed to negotiate a new contract with Hollywood, who are owned by Disney, which bought their old contract for $1 million. It was through their connections that the group was able to get rock legends like the aforementioned Alice Cooper, Steve Jones of the Sex Pistols, who plays guitar on this track, and Slash of Guns N' Roses, who appears on a future track.
Yeah.
After this album's completion, the Disney-owned label, I cannot stress this enough, demanded lyrical changes, which the two members of ICP complied with, and 100,000 copies of the record were released to stores on June 24th. These ended up being removed from shelves the very same day. ICP were in an in-store record signing when they were informed that all of their in-store signings and tour dates had been canceled, and they'd been dropped from the label. Even though 18,000 copies had already been sold, and the Great Milenko had debuted on number 63 on the Billboard 200 chart.
Is that considered a collector's item, then, if you get one of those 18,000?
I don't know. I didn't think to look on Discogs.
Yeah, so I think what happened was, in the late 90s, Mickey Mouse had to do some, like, jail time and like minimum security just for like tax evasion. So we left Goofy
he went to white collar prison.
So Goofy was in charge of A&R for a bit, and yeah, he was really bad into coke at that point. So he was calling up all his old like, disco buddy from the 70s, like, oh, yeah, I was hanging out with Johnny Rotten, Public Image Limited, and
I'm just
Steve
hanging
Jones.
Out with Fritz the Cat over here,
and I found these wicked clowns, and Goofy, what the hell are you doing? What the fuck did you do to my company?
Uh-oh, the gravy train's over.
That's him getting pushed out of the, you know, five-story window because Mickey's fucking nuts.
Oh, boy. So what
Speaking
had
of nuts, the Insane Clown Posse.
You look like shit, Goofy. There we go. How many days have you been staying up? How much dope you been doing?
I got bugs crawling up my spine, Mickey. I'm not doing so well.
Oh, gosh, so well.
Patrick's pretty good at the Disney impressions, I gotta say.
Donald's in the corner, he's not breathing.
Of course.
I'm not gonna make any of us try to do a Donald impression.
Child services have to take away Maxie.
Okay. What had happened was Disney was dealing with heavy criticism from the Southern Baptist Church Organization for their promotion of Gay Days at Disneyland and distribution of Ellen DeGeneres' 1990 sitcom, accusing the monolithic corporation of turning their back on family values. So ICP basically ended up being the whipping boys to avoid further controversy, even though Disney-owned Hollywood Records stated that in a press release that the album's release was an oversight by their review board. Which, someone's got to get fired.
Man.
How do you fuck that up?
Fuck the Southern
Baptists. How do you not do that kind of research?
They're so bad.
They are wieners. They're big wet blankets.
A bunch of fucking cunts is what they are.
Ultimately, this would all work in ICP's favor, though, as the controversy from the Hollywood Records debacle would garner huge interest from other major labels, and the duo were courted by Interscope and Geffen Records before ultimately landing at Island Records, where it was re-released on August 12th and would be certified platinum a year later. So that's fun.
No, it's not.
I guess not. I mean, fun that it all, you know, it all ended well for them, not
The
stuff that... I just said what happened.
Okay, I'll listen to it over again when the episode's out.
Oh, my God. Okay, let's move on to track number 5, this one titled, How Many Times?
How many times will I ask myself why don't we be friends?
How many times?
How many times will I ask myself why don't we be friends? Will I cry?
How many times will I wait in a line? It's 3:30, I fucking got here. I'm finally up to the front, can't wait to-
Third single off the Great Milenko, another one that didn't end up charting, a track about being driven over the edge by life's little inconveniences.
Oh, yeah.
Like being stuck in traffic, dealing with the DMV and judges.
Getting jukified.
Or if you're in Massachusetts, the RMV.
Very true.
Yes.
We've all been there. Mm. I think the RMV's improved a bit over the years. It was a lot worse. They've improved somewhat.
We have an express branch in Attleboro. It's awesome.
Oh,
that is
great.
Nice. Yeah, when you can. Yeah. Also, you can do shit online, which is nice.
Yeah.
So, this is the song about like being Joker-fied, basically.
Yeah, this is the falling down song.
Absolutely.
So up to this point, I've been taking all the tracks with a pretty big grain of salt, knowing full well they're not terribly high quality by traditional standards, and just sort of taking them as they are. This one kind of annoyed me a little bit.
I thought the beat was cool.
Yeah, the beat was pretty good, but the content was pretty dumb as far as I'm concerned.
It was pretty pretty accessible, I suppose.
I think I liked the beat, but I'm kind of with Lilz in that this was the track where like they were starting to get on my nerves a bit, and I was starting to remember why I don't like juggalos, or why I didn't like juggalos back in high school. I don't know. It's complicated. They were like, we didn't really have like a good counterculture in Norwood.
That's you and juggalos on Facebook. It's complicated.
Exactly. Like, I don't know. We didn't really have a good counterculture in Norwood. So it was all the weird kids, like, whether they were like music geeks or like goths or juggalos or like art kids or stoners, like they all just kind of like hung out at the same lunch table and like didn't necessarily get along, but we like all kind of depended on each other
and broke bread in peace.
Yeah, exactly.
You guys had an agreement.
We had an agreement. It was like, yes. down at the Oasis, all the yes, Lions, it's Buffaloes, and everyone,
the Norwood Truce of the mid-90s.
Mm.
Yeah, see, I was friends with a bunch of juggalos in high school.
The Norwood Accord.
Me too, and juggalo adjacent people, and this kind of reminded me of like, oh yeah, these miserable assholes, and this is why this is off putting to me. It's just so like, angsty and juvenile, so, I guess, at the same time.
It's just like doing a whole rap complaining about like the traffic is just like, what the fuck can you do? Why are you getting angry at that sort of shit? That solves nothing.
So I had a friend who went to Worcester State, and he was living on campus, and he said, for the most part, it was typical college, just a bunch of regular folks at college, and he'd go to the rec room and people be playing like pool or like just kind of taking a nap on the couches and shit. And then he said one day he went down there and it was fucking full of juggalos. And he's like, what the fuck is going on? And I guess one of them just stopped. They were like playing pool. One of them stopped and he was just like, what does it mean to be a juggalo? And just went off on like this fucking soapbox speech about being a juggalo. And come to find out, like, I guess there was some buddy at the school was friends with a juggalo, and he invited him to the college, and they realized that there was a rec room you could just hang out with, so there was just a fucking flood of juggalos that came in.
Did he just like recite the lyrics track 9 on this record, because it's literally called What is a Juggalo?
That's the story. As soon as I saw that track, I was like, that reminded me immediately of that story.
That's so funny.
Like that he just said, what does it mean to be a juggalo? Like he's a big street poet or something.
What's duff?
And immediately everyone dropped their pool cues and stood in awe. A guy with makeup on his face went, quiet, let him speak.
The great Milenko has spoken.
Milenko has returned.
All hell, the great Milenko. And then I had a girl that I went to high school with, and I immediately unfollowed her when she did this one day. She posted a fucking diatribe on Facebook about why we shouldn't make fun of juggalos and how it's a culture and nobody understands. And I was like, oh my God. Goodbye.
Oh, boy. Well, then. some slight foreshadowing in the final verse with a whole section knocking science, which they would do once again to great meme effect decades later with their infamous track Miracles.
How do they work?
The line goes as follows. How many times did I walk in and just sit and have to listen and learn all this bullshit? Learning history and science? Fucking wait. Knowing that, will that put food on my plate? Yeah, can I walk into McDonald's up to the counter and tell them you can make limestone from gunpowder? Will they give me a cheeseburger if I know that shit?
Damn.
I mean, will they?
Let's try it.
It's there.
Maybe you should try that the next time you're in Croc's Kingdom, Pat.
I'm pretty convinced that they know what they're talking about.
And you know what? Actually, let's just act that out now. Let's just improvise that real quick. You're Pat. You're in a McDonald's. I'll be the person at the counter at McDonald's. And Jim, you can be James Portnoy.
I'm me.
Yes, you're you.
Hello, right, me.
I changed my mind. You're Dave Mustaine now.
Okay.
And scene. Welcome to McDonald's.
Hey, what's going on? I'm Patrick S. Barry, but played by Dave Mustaine for some reason. Could I get some... Wait, what was it again? Limestone cheeseburger?
What was it? A limestone cheeseburger? Make a cheeseburger out of...
Scene. This went about as well as I thought it would go.
I'm having a little bit of trouble following their scientific method, I guess.
Oh my God, there's Dave Mustaine.
Yes.
Oh boy.
Here I am. While you eat.
As I've mentioned often before, I usually have genius.com up whenever I'm going track by track so I can read the lyrics as I go. And like many other Genius songs, this one's got some user-generated annotations, which are hilariously pointless. Like, ICP is a group that doesn't deal in big lyrical metaphor, so it pretty much just amounts to people just repeating the exact same thing Violent J just said. Like, there's a line that goes, how many times will I sit in a hot car, traffic jam, been sitting in it for a fucking hour, must be an accident, I hope nobody died, finally get there and the crash is on the other side. This needed an entire paragraph's worth of explanation from user I'm That One Guy, who opens with, it is not uncommon for cars AC to not work.
But in 1998, Violent J did attend several town meetings in the Detroit metropolitan area regarding like traffic flow and like widening some of the highways and just like a general like helping with traffic flow.
Oh yes, he was a real trailblazer for that sort of thing.
He was big into the into those automated toll booths so people wouldn't have to stop anymore. That was huge on mm-hmm. killing that 9 a.m. traffic.
So, yeah, I didn't like this song very much. It's just kind of 6 minutes of complaining.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's what Fuck the World is, too. But at least that one's funny.
What's next?
Track number 6, this one titled Southwest Voodoo. A bat, a tongue from a snake, a tail from a rat, a neck from a chicken, an eye from a crow, and a little bitty, little itty jet psycho. Once again, another track where everything is exactly as it says on the tin. It's ICP do their spook house shtick interpretation of voodoo.
Toe to tip. That's an ICP track.
That's a cool little trap beat, though. No,
a little bit, yeah.
Also, number three, Fago reference. A little itty bit of drip of Fago.
Are you counting these by like just like the number of Fago references in general, or like just by like there it is in one verse, there it is in a verse that there it is in the chorus, and if that chorus is repeated, like it still just counts as one.
Yeah, it's one reference, but they don't really say it in any of the choruses. Well, I mean, I guess in this one they do, but no, I'm only counting it as
in
one
the pre-chorus
as one.
Like I got all my stuff and a little bit of Fago.
Yeah,
or as they call it, a little bit of Fago.
Do they have a song like that actually references Fago in the title? Let me find out. Yeah, there's a song called Fago Song.
That would do it.
That'll do it.
I wonder if...
if not there, then where?
I'm genuinely curious if Faygo sales have gone up because of Insane Clown Posse.
1,000%.
They have to have.
Yeah. So I just found an article here on NME from like 2015 that said Insane Clown Posse cancels show after venue blocks use of soft drink Faygo.
Right. They traveled overseas and like they couldn't bring Faygo with them. I think there was like a story about like they got another brand of like UK soda that they just put Faygo labels on and it didn't work the same way at all.
Because Faygo's got that nice compression that we experienced when you open, that CO2 when you open the bottle.
Mm. It is kind of like opening a CO2 container.
Well, the venue actually had legitimate concerns because a big thing that they do at their shows is spraying Faygo on the audience, and they were concerned about like property damage that would happen from like fucking spraying a bunch of soda around and like
and then they ended up causing even more property damage though, because whatever soda they did end up using just flew out of control and hit a disco ball, knocking it loose.
I mean, imagine how sticky everything was after these shows. Like, Guar, they shoot all kinds of shit under the audience, too, but I feel like that's all, like...
Yeah, that's all washable.
Washable, meanwhile, water-based shit.
Meanwhile, with this shit, it's just...
Sugar.
It's just sticky-ass soda.
Yeah.
What did you say it was...
bring in Gallagher's brother to
three times the amount of a Coca-Cola or something like that?
Yeah, this has, like, 3 or 4 times the amount of sugar, like, that a 20-ounce of Coke would have.
It's,
It has 120% of your... of your daily value of added sugars.
Oh, that's great. So you'll be ahead of the game.
Yeah.
You won't have to drink. Every single
day. You won't have to drink one tomorrow, or at least you won't have to drink all of one tomorrow.
Or you just, like, drink a bunch of them now, and then you can, like, take a break.
By that, you mean you die. which is the longest break one can take.
Sounds beautiful.
Okay, so speaking of horrorcore, like this is something that's never quite landed with me as far as acts like ICP and, frankly, a lot of the rest of their psychopathic records ilk. On a surface level of understanding, it tends to be those acts that get to be the first name in the subgenre being called horror rap when they're really not particularly scary in the slightest. Like, there are actual legitimately disturbing hip-hop records by, like, Clipping or Cool Keith or Flatbush Zombies. And the title still ends up going to, like, ICP and their friends, where the horror conceit here is just more about, like, violence and gore.
Or a local hip-hop act, Camp Blood from Boston, is, like, a great example.
Right, good local example.
And, like, actually references a horror film, Friday the 13th.
Mm. Like, it's the difference between Heredity and Hostel, where one manages to generate real thrills and creepiness on a psychological level, while the other is just a guy going chainsaw, 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 chainsaw over and over again.
Well, it's like it's not so much playing on the, you know, actual scariness of horror, but more just the campiness of it, I guess.
Yeah, I guess so.
Because it's very tongue-in-cheek at the same time. So it's sort of this general mishmash of, like, comedy... you know, softcore and fucking
that's true. Let it not be said, at least, that ICP take themselves too seriously.
No, and I think, like, that's what kind of ends up saving a lot of these tracks at the end of the day.
On that note, I was very ready to, like, write this whole track off as just being because it was all just very obvious references to voodoo dolls and questionable tribal drum sampling till I get to this part.
Why you think voodoo's fake? Come to the graveyard, I'll make the dead wake. Raise, sugar bomba, sleep no longer, raise, quick. Raise, raise, sugar bomba, leave us alone, you fucking punk bitch. Fucking, I ain't that good yet, but one day you can bet I'm a freak.
What was that?
Freak.
What was that?
I don't know. They're just having a big old goof.
That's what I mean when I say it's really hard to outright dislike this group sometimes. Like, the moment they seem like they're running on autopilot, all of a sudden Violent J botches a zombie resurrection and makes angry squirrel noises.
Yeah, very dependable.
It's very hard to, like, get too disappointed at this sort of stuff.
Hey, Jay, what's in the bag? A shrunken head and a shriveled scrotum sack.
Nuts.
Nuts.
Oh, boy.
Nerds.
Nerds. Moving on to track number 7, here's Halls of Illusions. This one, the lead single off the record, managed to reach number 56 on the UK singles chart, features Slash of Guns N' Roses on rhythm guitar, and pretty ripping solo near the end, too.
Yeah.
Also make another appearance.
Of course.
And I wave my wand.
Waving your wand.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this one had a pretty good beat. And again, like, you take out all the ridiculous lyrics and you know, this is like, you know, typical Detroit 90s rap right here.
Yeah, and like at its root, the lyrics are basically just about abusers getting what they deserve.
Yeah.
And that's always nice.
Yeah, they're pretty good
in a very
about,
Schadenfreude kind of way.
Well, yeah, they're pretty good at like kind of the Schadenfreude stuff here and there. I did appreciate the redneck incest prone redneck getting his just dessert in that past track. And yeah.
I mean, when you read the I kind of went down the rabbit hole when you guys said we were going to be doing this album, and I went on the Insane Clown Posse Wikipedia, and I was kind of reading about
wait, you must tell us what this Wikipedia is called.
It's just the insane clown posse.
It's not a Jugopedia.
No. Rip off.
No, but like they're talking about how, you know, there was a whole thing at the end of it all where they were like, oh, hey, we got you. We're like, not Christians, but they were kind of trying to send this message of good and evil the whole time. And their whole shtick was like, we have songs about, you know, being a good guy and songs about being a bad guy. And you're going somewhere, whether you like it or not, or some shit like that.
What is a clown? What does it mean to be a clown?
So
the
this
most
song,
ancient clowns have been found in the 5th dynasty of Egypt around 2400 BC.
Oh,
unlike court jesters,
oh, you're, okay, you're going somewhere with this.
No, I'm not.
No, keep going. You started down this path. You're going to fucking finish it. Tell us more about the history of clowns.
Unlike court jesters, clowns have traditionally served a socio-religious and psychological role, and traditionally the roles of the priest and clown have held by the same person. Peter Berger writes, it seems plausible that folly and fools, like religion and magic, meet some deeply rooted needs in human society. For this reason, clowning is considered an important part of training as a physical performance discipline, partly because of the tricky subject matter that can be dealt with, but also because it requires a high level of risk and play in the performer. In anthropology, the term clown has been extended to comparable jester or fool.
Okay, that's enough.
In non-Western cultures.
Stop. God damn it. So this song, we already talked about like how the production on this record is pretty good. This one, like especially, like I like, it's all like hazy and very acid-flecked. And like, across the album, there's like this very unique kind of sound among hip-hop at the time. It's got like all the hallmarks of that iconic classic boom-bap 90s song of the sound of the time period. But there's also like a very heavy emphasis on like dark atmospheric and very layered macabre instrumentation, almost reminiscent of Danny Elfman at times.
Yeah, the Slash guitar stuff was pretty fitting and well-mixed, I thought.
Yeah, those come courtesy of a guy by the name of Mike E. Clark, a name that I've pretty much only known to have been connected to ICP, but his discography goes to some pretty interesting places when I looked it up. In addition to doing some production work for a whole lot of Detroit rappers like Esham and future racist shithead Kid Rock, he's also done production work on albums as varied as Primal Scream, George Clinton, R.L. Burnside, and John Fogerty. So yeah, he's got some multitudes.
Well, that explains how George Clinton and the Funky Parlor, whatever the hell it is, ended up at the gathering.
Yeah, George Clinton, I think, was originally supposed to be on this record, but like the track that they recorded his vocals for, like, got rejected by Hollywood. Don't give Mike E. Clark too much credit, though. He's also responsible for producing All Summer Long. That shitball summer song.
Oh, God, no, I hate that fucking
is that
song.
The, is that the Sweet Alabama ripoff one?
Sweet Alabama and Werewolves of London.
It's very bad.
I remember I was at, when I was working for Microsoft, I went out to a fucking conference, and Microsoft did this event thing in one of the fucking conference halls on the Redmond campus, where they just basically set up a stage with a bunch of instruments, and anybody who was like a musician could get up and play. So I was like, all right, cool. So
this is going to go so horribly.
I got up on stage, and I was like, I'm going to play the drums. And this dude from Detroit got up and started playing guitar, and he turns to me, and there's a Swedish guy on bass, and he was fucking awesome. And him and I were like, this guitarist gets on stage, and he's like, all right, he's like, I'm from Detroit, so I want to do a Kid Rock song. And he starts playing that fucking song. And the bassist and I look at each other, and we're like, no, fuck this guy. So he got into, like, the first verse, and we changed it to Sweet Home Alabama, at least. So it was, yeah.
Just started playing Kick Out the Jams by MC5.
Yeah.
That's a genuinely nice story that you and this sweetest bassist just had this moment of just looking at each other and going, nope.
that is cool.
I wish I got the dude's name because he was really good. I was like, let's do a fucking collaboration, man. Fucking anti-Kid Rock album.
That's Jeremy David. He's been on the Old Men Yell At Lilz show from time to time.
Yeah.
Yeah, I miss him already. I miss Jeremy Dave.
Yeah.
Dave, anyway,
here I am, Jeremy Dave.
Oh, you came back, Jeremy Dave. Goodbye, thing. I'm going to leave again. No, is, Jeremy Dave, goodbye.
Why does he sound like Dr. Nick?
Maybe yeah. If he
time
comes
for
back,
your booster!
The most rewarding part was when he gave me my money. So I'll just close out my thoughts with another unintentionally silly genius annotation. When it gets to the hook of the song, for one reason or another, there's a highlight link around the X2 denoting that the hook repeats twice. When you click on it, you get an explanation from user GSN194, a.k.a. Garrick, reading, they said it twice.
Thank God I would never be able to put that together.
Thank you for that. Here's track number 8, this one titled Under the Moon. Little bit of very early trap hi-hats in that little opening part of the beat right there.
Yeah, this is so. I know we were kind of talking about earlier how everything's very kind of straightforward,
surface level.
But this one was like, I feel like this was their attempt at being deep.
I kind of agree with you there. Like of all the tracks, this probably comes the closest to like actually being like legitimately unsettling,
trying to have some emotion at all. Like, hey, I killed this person for you, and I went to jail, and you said we were going to be together forever, and then I got out, yeah, and you pretended and then, like you didn't know who I was.
Yeah, and then the lyrics get all kind of incel-y.
Oh yeah, this is the one where he says fuck the moon or something, but I kept kept thinking that he was saying like
I want to rub my nuts on the moon.
Oh,
fuck
yeah.
You and the moon.
Oh, that's what I said. Fuck you, Annie Mo. That's what I kept saying.
Fuck you, Annie Mo.
Yeah, this song sucked. This one was not one of my faves.
I didn't think it was that bad, personally. Like, at the very least, the production on here was still really good and, like, a very effective mood builder.
Yeah, I mean, the production was fine. Yeah, I was kind of turned off by that last section, though.
Yeah, pretty much. There's like a web archived interview from the old ICP website, apparently conducted by a gentleman by the name of Jelly Nuts. Okay. Violent J describes the track thusly. It's all serious and shit. That's why we put it at the end of side ones on the new Milenko, so all the hardcore ninjas can just fast forward and flip the tape. That kind of seems like a patent admission that they don't think the song is very good. I mean, that's certainly a take.
It is halfway through, isn't it? Yeah, it's track 8.
But anyway, he continues, for the other ninjas who are like me and sometimes dig the serious shit, they call themselves ninjas sometime, by the way, It's about this kid and his girlfriend in high school. Somebody tries to rape the girl, so the kid shoots him in the face and goes to prison for life. All for his bitch, I might add. Anyhow, after a few years, the bitch forgets about him and leaves him in jail to rot. It's a deep, deep song. Deep and wide like your mom's Neddin.
Oh, cool.
Cool.
Thanks. That's just like... Like, any espousing of it being deep is just, like, instantly destroyed by fucking misogynistic combat towards your mom. You know what I mean?
So,
it's very deep and emotional. A little bit puss.
So, I got to ask you guys. I know when you put up the Facebook post about how we were doing this episode and you tagged Violent J, is that his actual Facebook account? Because I'm looking at it right now.
No idea.
And he doesn't really have I mean, there's like a pretty good amount of likes and comments, but I would expect more for somebody who's like a cult leader, pretty much.
Like, it's like the face of the cult and the face of the cult at that.
September 16th, 2016. Super excited for Florida with my boy Tech 9E. It's gonna be dope.
Tech 9, that's the group that they play with, yeah.
Oh, it's going to be dope. And then, like, June 14th, wow, I've been gone off here for a minute. Damn, been busy with a lot of shit, haven't had time to see what's been going on with my lows and my lets. Hope we were all fucking shit up.
Oh, good.
Are there any posts after that?
The most recent one was 2016 about being super excited for Tech 9.
We got a comment from Naomi Mares. I want you to meet my mom. Not Naomi's mom. That's my mom. I'm using her profile like as if it were my very own. Tell Shaggy he's sexy. That was 44 weeks ago.
Okay, cool.
About section, Violent J is only described by one word.
Badass.
Okay, badass. Technically two words.
That's one word.
Yeah, okay.
I mean, he's one of those people who says a lot is one word, so, you know.
See, I would have figured he would have gone. See, I would have figured he would have gone with violent. Cuz it's right there in the title.
Or J,
that's there too. Only one word can be used to describe Violent J. Lentj.
That's the letters in the middle.
Here's track number 9. This one asks the all important question. What is a juggalo?
What is a juggalo? A fucking lunatic. Somebody with a rope tied to his dick. Then he jumps out a 10-story window. Oh. What is a juggalo?
A juggalo. Ask what it is. Well, fuck if I know.
What is a juggalo?
I don't know.
What is a juggalo? Like, they're asking us this. I don't know. You guys came up with the term.
Right.
Don't ask us.
I do not know. No, I think it's a rhetorical question. Apparently, they tie something to their dick and throw themselves out a window and do all sorts of these crazy things.
And he's that's literally man. All it is. It's all about tying ropes to your dick and just being nude all the time.
That's all it takes. That's what it means to be a clown.
We cracked the code. All right, this one, a big rallying cry for ICP's famed fan base, the Juggalos, describing their fans as nudists who braid their pubes, teabag people's soup, didn't graduate from high school, and then fully admit they have no idea what Juggalos are.
Oh, the soup thing. Yeah, a lot of nips. Nuts in soup.
Nuts. It's just basically just a random, silly... like teenage vulgarity for its own sake, and it's presented with like such conviction and confidence that once again it's just really hard to outwardly dislike it. Like, it's just like, what do you want?
It's very silly,
especially when they do like crazy meta shit with their rapping, like in the aforementioned clip and this one that I just had to cut a portion of because I love it too much.
What is a juggalo? A dead body. Well, he ain't really dead, but he ain't like anybody that you've ever met before. He'll eat Monopoly and shit out Connect Four. What is a juggalo?
What the fuck, Connect? Man, that shit. Don't worry about my shit. Just rap, motherfucker.
That part actually did get a genuine.
Yeah, I laughed at that.
There is no way these guys weren't influenced by Old Dirty Bastard from Wu-Tang Clan, because he would do this kind of thing all the time. Just be like weird for its own sake as a means of deconstructing rapping.
Oh, the false stops are fucking hilarious. Yeah.
I don't know if that's specifically what ICP were going for, but it is incredibly entertaining.
I appreciated that. It was like got some genuine laughter from me.
Yeah, me too. So, like, since they technically never get around to outright defining what a juggalo is, we instead turn to Wikipedia for their page on the subculture.
Oh, boy.
Common characteristics of identifying a member of the juggalo subculture are as follows. Drinking and spraying the inexpensive soft drink Faygo. Check. listening to horrorcore and other types of underground rap music. Wearing face paint, generally those either like an evil clown or perhaps similar to corpse paint. Wearing hatchet gear, which I guess is a brand of juggalo stuff. Okay. Having the Hatchet Man logo applied on personal effects and die cast worn as jewelry.
Wow.
Doing hair in the spider leg style, i.e. like the Twisted members. That's another juggalo group.
They played in Attleboro.
Really?
Yep. At Jared's place.
I'm sure they do.
No longer in existence.
Wait, CB's brother Jared?
No. That's his cousin.
Is that Jared? Did they play his cousin? Did they play at CB's cousin's place?
Yeah, at the diner that he works at.
It goes on. Displaying the gesture of Wicked Clown, the West Side sign with the left hand and the C sign in ASL with the right with arms crossed over. I don't know what this is.
I do. It's like they do the...
Well, yeah, the West Side sign is a thing.
Oh,
wicked clowns.
Ah, yeah. Okay.
They have the C.
Making clown. And responding to whoop whoop calls.
Ooh, whoop whoop.
I love the whoop whoop.
And expressing a generally tongue-in-cheek obsession with murder committed with a blade weapon.
Hmm.
A lot of these characteristics originated back in the 1980s when Violent J, then Joseph Bruce, grew up in poverty, receiving clothes from rummage sales and food from canned food drives. He and his brother Robert were often the butt of jokes from their peers, but they refused to be ashamed of their living standards and instead outwardly embraced them. He even came up with a slang name for the two of them and various friends who also embraced the upbringing. Floobs.
Okay.
I'm glad they stuck with Juggalo.
I think I want to be a Juggalo. For
that
Halloween
has a
next
than,
year.
That has a better ring to it than Floobs.
I'll just take a trip to my local Hot Topic, and I'll have my Juggalo Halloween costume ready for next year.
Just walk up to the counter and say, give me the full Juggy.
No, just slam my Faygo on the counter. I want to be a Juggalo. And then the person behind the counter pushes a special button, and like this door opens in the back of Hot Topic, and what's it called? Dry ice, like smoke comes out from it, and then you go
come
back
right
and,
in, my friend.
Yeah,
it's like I want to be a Juggalo, and the guy behind the counter's like, gulp, here we go.
Then there's a montage
the song. Step out, fully Juggaloed out, and it's July. Now I just have to keep this up until October's end.
It's November.
No, I didn't. In the hypothetical scenario.
In the hypothetical October.
Yeah, it's November in the he missed Halloween. And he's just getting his costume now.
Shit!
So Floob was essentially a scrub, but not just an ordinary scrub. Man, I have not heard the term scrub since like...
A scrub is a guy who cannot get no love from me or something
right.
like that.
Yeah, that was kind
of
like...
hanging out the passenger side of his best friend's ride.
Yeah.
No scrubs was like the height of people using that term, too.
Oh, yeah.
And yes, it was like wore the same clothes and shitty shoes from rummage sales. Though Joe Lee specifically names himself and his brother as Floobs, he alludes to other Floobs whom he has not met or known. So a Floob is really just a Floob you haven't met yet.
I suppose it is. Here's track number 10. This one this one is titled House of Horrors.
I'm a phantom. Listen to me. I didn't do it. How about this? I'm so scary. They call me Joey Terrifying. Did you know that?
Yeah.
No, you didn't. I was lying. Bathroom share. It's right there down the hall. Don't flush it, though. I'll make dinner for you all. I'm possessed, too. Wait a minute. Hey, don't leave me yet. Hey.
Okay.
I do this love the part in this song where he's like, he goes, "Bird, you don't know what that is because nobody does that." Bird, bird.
This is the part of the episode where I've come to realize I haven't been giving these guys nearly enough credit. Here I've been spouting out about how the horror aspect keeps missing the mark and that a lot of the songs don't offer much beyond surface-level vulgarity. And then comes this incredibly good track about ICP failing to scare two yuppie dinguses at a haunted house over and over again. And this is just so fucking good.
Yeah, it is a welcome window of self-awareness. Yeah, I got a huge kick out of this track, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's that level of self-awareness and willingness to mock yourself that's frankly very refreshing, especially like during this time period in hip-hop history. Like stone-faced gangster rap is what's holding sway in the mainstream right now.
So it actually reminds me of a friend of mine who I from high school who I know was big into ICP. He wasn't like a dyed-in-the-wool juggalo, but he definitely, you know, bought all the records and you know, we watched fucking Big Money Hustlers together back in high school. And, like, he's a professional or, like, semi-pro wrestler now, so, like, it kind of tracks that it just has this, like, yeah, like, similar,
they love
like,
their
campiness.
Wrestling.
Yeah, they were, before they got big, they were really into, like, the backyard wrestling stuff.
Yeah, so is this kid, so, like, that totally tracks. So it's kind of, like, similar similar cultures happening there, and but like he's kind of like similar in that he's like very self-aware of his own you know goofiness
of how silly it all is,
of how silly the whole thing is, but also like, you know, them trying to be tough at the same time. And yeah, it's very entertaining, and this kind of like reminded me of like what I like about professional wrestling.
Yeah, so I like this track. I mean, it's a lot of the same stuff as previous tracks sound-wise and flow-wise, and they kind of fall back into old, like, murder, murder, murder lyrics by the third verse, but the premise leading up to it is just so, so good. It really heightens it for me. That willingness to just winkingly acknowledge that this might be a little bit silly is, like, I appreciate that very much.
Yeah, and this is a Legs. Legs Diamond appears on this one as well. He's on a few of them. I don't know who the hell he is.
Their old buddy Legs Diamond, who, as far as I'm aware, I have no idea if he's friends with Jim Beans or not.
Jim Beans.
Oh, he totally is. He totally is.
Your search continues, Jim.
Beans.
Who's friends with the Bean Man?
I need beans.
Why won't you give the man some beans?
Pork flat, Ren. Pork fat, Ren. Pork fat floats on beans. God, I love that episode. Ren and Stimpy try to get into Canada, and there's just a mode of baked beans between the United States and Canada.
They refer to it as the Promised Land.
Yeah.
Shall we get into track number 11?
Yeah, let's. We're not on the home stretch, but.
All right. I mean, we're going through these pretty quickly, comparatively. Here's track number 11, this one titled Boogie Woogie Woo.
Moonlight fills the room that you sleep in. Things go bump in the night, me creeping. Ouch, fuck, I stubbed my toe. If you just quit leaving your shit all over the fucking floor. Fuck it, you're dead anyway. And I'ma leave your head smack dead in the hallway. In the morning when your daddy walks out, ah, foot's in your mouth.
Another solo track from Violent J with occasional hype manning from Shaggy 2 Dope. And it's still kind of falling back into old habits about, like, Violent J's going around killing your children, but it's hasn't gotten boring yet so far.
I love the fucking backing vocals, the female vocals on this.
Yeah,
it's that's a welcome hook, especially, yeah. Like, up to this point, it's always just been just a bunch of dudes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not sure who does them. It's probably the Gone Girl.
Deb Agioli.
Gone Girls. You know, Goo Gone, the stuff that the adhesive remover.
Yes, the Goo Gone Girls.
Not to be confused with the Goo Goo Dolls.
No, definitely not.
The Goo Gone
Johnny
Dolls.
Johnny Resnick is not there. Yeah. Or the other guy, whatever his name is, Mitch Hedberg.
So I don't have a lot to say about this one. Like, it has a lot of, like, sort of the same, like, tropes. Like, some of them have gotten tired by this point, but on the whole, it's still, like, kind of an entertaining track. So I'm going to talk a little bit about, like, the aftermath of Great Milenko, because the behind-the-scenes craziness doesn't just end with the album's release. Here's a funny little anecdote we alluded to earlier. Nationwide tour ensued after Milenko's release, rescheduled from when the album was originally intended for release on Hollywood Records, again, a Disney label! with opening acts Misery and House of Crazies. who had quit partway through their tours after abruptly breaking up. During a stop in Detroit, Violent J would be approached by then-unknown rapper Eminem, with a flyer advertising a release party for his debut Slim Shady EP. The flyer read, featuring appearances by Esham, Kid Rock, and ICP.
Maybe
in parentheses. When questioned why Eminem put ICP's name on a flyer without consulting them, he said to have replied, "It says maybe. Maybe you'll be there. I don't know. That's why I'm asking you right now. Are you guys coming to my release party or what?"
Yes, I'm there.
I don't know. I have diarrhea.
I have to, paint my cat.
I had a thing.
Paint the cat.
Anyway, Bruce responded, "Fuck no, I ain't coming to your party. We might have if you would have asked us first before putting this on the fucking flyer like this." This set up a beef between ICP and Eminem, which inspired several diss tracks and barbs between the two groups, including but not limited to a skit on the Marshall Mathers LP depicting the duo giving Eminem oral sex, and a parody from ICP of Eminem's hit track My Name Is titled Slim Anus. So there it is right there.
Slim Anus.
It was probably easier to get people angry back then. The beef would inevitably be squashed in 2005, though, and Eminem would even shout out ICP on a track of his in his 2013 record, the Marshall Mathers LP, too. So that's a sort of happy ending-ish.
I wonder how that went down. They just, like, ran into just like, hey, we cool? Yeah, we cool.
Yeah, okay. It was kind of like the Good Friday Agreement of UK and in Ireland, where they sort of like acknowledged certain things. The Belfast Agreement, they acknowledged certain things, but they were at a stalemate, so they couldn't really continue the fight any longer.
Right.
What do we got?
History Box Zeroes. Anyway. Track 13, oh, not 13, track number 12, this one titled The Neddin Game.
Okay, first I slide up to the bar and tell you that I can't believe how fucking fat you are. I tell you that I like the way you make your titty shake, and if you lost a little weight, you'd look like Ricky Lake. Fuck that! You'd be talking me quick, I'd order you a drink.
This fucking thing.
It's probably easier to make people laugh back then, too. God.
Well, you know what? I remember as soon as I heard the beginning of this, I was like, holy shit. My childhood came flashing back at me because I remember one of my friends as a kid. Like, Jesus Christ. I had to have been in elementary school, I think. Or maybe like the very beginning of middle school. And I remember my friend showing this to me, and we were like in the basement, like.
Good God.
I said nuts. Teehee.
Yeah.
Oof. This one's, this one is really trying to be funny, but,
It's pretty bad.
It's pretty rough.
Yeah.
It's pretty crass.
It's not very good. Like, I mean, if this is ICP making a concerted effort to do a funny song, then, like, that really makes me upset for, like, all those kind words I had for House of Horrors.
I heard this song the same day I heard Tollbooth Willie off of Adam Sandler's album for the first time.
What?
Oh, that's perfect. Because yeah. I think was that the same year?
Probably.
They're all going to laugh at you?
Yeah, I think so.
And you found it on Napster, and it was credited to Weird Al Yankovic.
Absolutely. I definitely did that. Oh, man. Eat shit. Eat my shit.
Eat my fucking repeating shit.
So I know I've given.
I still yell that at toll booth workers to this day.
So I know I've given ICP credit for throwing caution to the wind and just reveling in just a sense of deliberate stupidity at times. This one is just kind of dumb and annoying in a very well trodden, didn't age well kind of way for like most late 90s media. It's like, yeah, this is too stupid. Turn it back.
Yeah, like, I know that the person who's, like, the narrator of the song is, like, obviously supposed to be repulsive and shitty, but, like, yeah, it's a tough spice to throw out there, and, didn't necessarily read very well for me.
Mm. It's basically like going back and listening to the Jerky Boys or watching an old Newgrounds animation where they just murder a celebrity. Yeah. It's like the kind of thing that probably seemed a lot cooler before hormones happened.
So I didn't know what a Neddin was, so I had to look that up.
Oh, yes, I had to look it up on Urban Dictionary.
And the definition for all of you folks playing at home, a term used for the vagina of a juggalette or a female ICP van. They are almost always loose, smelly, hairy, not often washed, and usually infected with genital warts.
What the fuck? Is that like... Are they complimenting that? Is that good?
Jim's Trivia Corner! supposedly, this track is considered one of the group's signature songs and is a popular live staple. It's just
really?
Not very good.
How did that?
It's not very good, like
there's
at
so
all.
So many other grade A songs they could have used instead of this one.
Yeah. On the other hand, though, there was this one time that Shaggy 2 Dope drop-kicked film director Fred Durst mid Limp Bizkit concert, and Iron Sheik had to play Peacemaker.
Oh. What?
That has nothing to do with this song. I thought it was just more interesting than
that. Is
that
very
was just
interesting.
More interesting than this.
Yeah, that's way more interesting than anything that happened in this song. Good God!
Oh boy,
I'm a big Sheik stan right here.
I just pulled it up on. I just pulled up the NME page. Wrestling legend the Iron Sheik intervenes after Insane Clown Posse Shaggy 2 Dope tried to dropkick Limp Bizkit's Fred Durst. The feud of the century. Wrestling legend the Iron Sheik has attempted to broker peace after Insane Clown Posse Shaggy 2 Dope attempted to dropkick Limp Bizkit's Fred Durst during a performance last week. The Rollin' Band were playing New Jersey's Rock Allegiance Festival when Shaggy emerged on stage. He quickly ran towards the front man, trying to dropkick him off the stage from behind. When the move didn't go quite to plan, a bemused Durst told the crowd, "What a pussy, he couldn't even pull it off." Security then intervened with the singer telling him to calm down, it's just one guy. The new metal outfit had just covered Faith by George Michael when the incident happened. Where's the part where it gets to Iron Sheik?
It's a lot of things happen.
As the beef escalates, an unlikely peacemaker has emerged in the form of wrestling legend the Iron Sheik. And this is all caps, mind you. The Shaggy 2 Dope, you are a good man, but your dropkick is fucking drizzling shits, Sheik wrote on Twitter. Also, at DJ Lethal is my brother. I don't like to see my brothers fight Bubba.
Oh, no, Bubba. Gormer the Frog, I don't like to see you fight Bubba. Fred Durst the Frog, I don't like to see you. Just make the biscuit.
Gormer the Frog.
Just make the biscuit.
Life is interesting. Here's track number 13, titled Hallelujah. Money.
This is the one with the fucking Southern Baptist preacher man in the background. And when that started, it immediately made me think of the last track on Tool's Undertow, Disgustipated, with the... and the angel said unto me,
that,
these are the cries of the carrots, the cries of the carrots.
Also had a televangelist on it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was like Maynard doing that televangelist.
You see, Maynard, Reverend, tomorrow is Harvest Day, and to them it is the Holocaust.
Oh, yeah. The rabbits.
This one, another solo track from Violent J. He gets, like, so many solo tracks on here, and Shaggy 2 Dope has to just sit off and go like, yeah, I'll just watch.
Yeah, well, you know what? To be honest, I think Violent J is just the stronger rapper in the posse that is of the Insane Clown.
He's clearly the
persuasion.
He's the Daryl Hall of that operation.
This one feels like another good one to me, especially coming on the heels of a stinker like Neddin game. Like, we're back to the very trip-hoppy, tricky-like production from Mikey Clark, and I can always appreciate a song taking down both organized religion and televangelists, which, against all logic, are still a thing.
Yeah, I think, like, for me, 11 and 12 were a bit of a dip for me, and then, once we get to 13, it kind of picks back up again.
Are the Southern Baptist and televangelists the same thing?
No, Southern Baptist is a denomination.
Okay.
Well, televangelist specifically does shit on television.
They're the ones who, like, electrocute people. Like, oh, yeah, he feels the power of the Lord, and they're flopping around
that's
on the
like
stage.
Evangelists, those are like what, that's like a specific sect of Christianity evangelists.
Gotcha. Yeah, they got like the TV shows, they're always calling on people to send them money.
Yep. Yeah.
But then deep into your hearts and your pockets for all the, you know, whatever,
yeah,
money.
It's kind of like there's a little bit of comparative weirdness at play here, considering that we were just talking about how earlier, like, they're basically just like a Christian group.
Yeah, right.
I mean, they deny that they're a Christian group, but they also make all kinds of references to, like, heaven and the Holy Ghost, which are very, very Christian sort of concepts.
Pro-spiritual, anti-ecclesiastical sort of mentality.
We can dive into that in the last track, I think.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Certainly.
What I will say, the one thing I will say is that regardless of whether you believe they are or aren't, like, imagine you're a fan who's, like, completely on board with all of it, from aesthetic to mythos across 8 studio albums, only to be informed, like, this was all a big morality play.
Yep.
That's kind of cheap. Like, just completely leaving out the whole morality play here, if you're gonna create your own mythology, then stick to it, instead of just being like, it was Jesus all along.
I don't know. I thought that was pretty hilarious. I wish I could have seen the looks on their juggalo faces.
Well, I mean, at no point did, like, Guar ever go like, oh, scum doggy is a Jesus thing, after all. I'm just looking at it from a literary perspective is all.
I still love when Guar went on Jerry Springer. That was great.
That's great.
I've got the best Guar story. My friend used to have this cell phone, this big stupid cell phone that he kept on his belt on the side of his leg, and it would get caught on everything. Like, it was a running joke that it just kept getting caught on everything. And we went to a Guar show, and Odorous Arungus was doing, like, signings or something. And his phone got caught on Odorous Arungus's fucking cock.
No.
And Odorous was like, oh. Yeah.
Here's track number 14, titled Down With The Clown.
What if I want the world's like, fuck us, kill us, what will you be? What about when the carnival comes to your town?
I'ma be down with the clown.
How long will you be down with a kettle puppet? I say I'm sick in the nugget, and you love it. I ain't a dead body, I ain't proud of it. I told you all about it, and you all applaud it.
In which Mr. J and Two Dope insist that they are going to stay hard and clowny forever and never be Menudo.
This is the cultist song. Like, this is the one where juggalos are swearing their allegiance to the juggalo way.
It kind of is, isn't it?
Yeah. Like, I don't...
Track 14, that's a good spot to stick your propaganda track and like, to really, like, soak in that subliminal message.
Like, how much more sinister would this song be if, like, during that extended part at the end, when they're just saying, down with the clown over and over again, very, very slowly the sound of marching started fading in. And then, like, a riff just started coming in that's very slowly just like, down with the clown, down with the clown.
Like hammer. It's like the, like, echoes of the Red Army Choir in the background.
I was specifically going with the Waiting for the Worms by Pink Floyd.
That too. Perfect.
So this is basically what is a juggalo again.
But now,
about it.
So you have to learn. So this is what they're doing here. In track 9, they're saying, all right, you're going to learn what a juggalo is. And then by track 14, you're going to swear your allegiance to the Insane Clown Posse, and you're going to be down with the clown until you fucking die.
Dude, you're going to be down with the clown. You're going to sequester with the jester till your dying days.
You just came up with that?
Yes.
You should send that to them. Maybe they'll use that.
That's good. That's good. Or maybe they'll sue you.
Yeah, that too.
Oh, boy. So... yeah, this is just another rallying cry song for their fan base, which expanded drastically after their previous album, Riddlebox, like got them just a whole bunch of new fans. So they wrote that and What Is a Juggalo as shout outs to their newfound fan base.
This one's just kind of eh.
I don't think it hits like in the same way that What Is a Juggalo did.
Right.
No, probably not. It's a later album track. My sister definitely had Riddlebox. I'm looking at the album cover now, and I 100% recognize it. It would have been right around that time in '95. Because I remember her like coming home with that and Smells Like Candy from Marilyn Manson that same day.
What a combination!
What a combo! Yeah.
Mm. Oh boy! Oh boy! When I initially announced that we were doing the Great Milenko, lots of people commented like other albums that we should have considered doing. This and the album that came after this, the Amazing Jekyll Brother, like the Riddlebox and Amazing Jekyll Brothers, were ones that were pretty constantly brought up. I don't know. I just went with the one that seemed to be the most popular.
Yeah, I mean, looking through the like all music ratings, they all kind of fall around like three.
Yeah, that's the thing. We couldn't just pick the worst reviewed. We couldn't just pick the worst reviewed record this time around because no one has given Insane Clown Posse a good review. Pretty much, not even our best friend Stevie.
Yeah, I saw
he
that.
he gave the next record 4 out of 5. Amazing Jekyll Brothers, and he's like pretty. Again, he's like pretty fair in some ways. Like he gives proper consideration for the music in addition to like the silly lyrics.
Mm. Right. Okay, now we're just about to reach the home stretch right here. I'm going to play these next two tracks back to back, not because they sound similar necessarily like how previously done, but because they kind of tie into each other thematically.
Right.
Here's back to back, here's Just Like That and Pass Me By.
Jump out of bed in a head.
So the sequence of events is as follows. Violent J gets up in the morning, absolutely detests Grape Nuts, and goes to meet up with his Juggalo homies, or Juggalomies, to do some Juggalo-adjacent things, and ends up getting shot in a drive-by. That's what happens in Just Like That, and I can't stress enough how important it is to remember how much Violent J just fucking hates those Grape Nuts.
You missed an important part, though. He's trying to get a ride or whatever, but he needs to stop and get the Faygo.
Right.
There's two Faygo references in Just Like That and two Faygo references in Pass Me
By. Those are the two main bullet points. He needs to get the Faygo and fucking Grape Nuts.
He had a Faygo like aging in the fridge that was like just ready.
He said it was ill and it was flat.
It was ill. Ready to go. And then, like, the Grape Nuts thing, if he ate his fucking Grape Nuts that morning, maybe he wouldn't have died. Sorry.
That's the thing. He did eat the Grape Nuts because there's also a line about how his mouth still tastes like Grape Nuts in spite of jugging down an entire Faygo.
Yeah, okay.
What if it was
nuts,
Grape Faygo?
Again, with the fucking nuts.
Oh, there's probably Grape Faygo out there.
Oh, there definitely is.
Grape Nuts do not taste like grape.
I would drink Grape Faygo. Grape is my favorite. What do we got? Oh, there we go. Yeah, look at that shit. That looks terrible.
See, I'm genuinely curious about the root beer Faygo now because I really like root beer. Anyway, then it's followed up by Pass Me By, in which Jay and company awaken in the Juggalo equivalent of heaven known as Shangri-La. And all their greatest desires are brought to fruition. And they tell you that you too can find your way to Shangri-La if you're good boys.
Yeah, if you're a Juggalo,
dope.
If you're a which good really Juggalo, like, you're going to get up there and you're going to get Faygo on tap.
Yeah, which really should have been like, you should have seen that reveal coming much, much earlier than when they revealed it on the Wraith.
I think they missed a perfectly great opportunity to call it Shagraloo dope.
Shagraloo? Hang on. What? Say that again. What did you think that they should have called it, Pat?
Shagraloo dope.
Shagraloo dope. That's what we're going with.
It's like a portmanteau of Shangri-La and Shaggy Two Dope.
No portmanteau for Violent J in there either.
Fuck that.
I don't know.
Okay.
That's just what worked.
That's fair. So, but yeah, like Jim said, you get Faygo on tap and they wash themselves with it.
Yeah. You know, this is another track where we mentioned this on track 8 on Under the Moon, where it was like their attempt at kind of being deep. I felt like this was a little less deep than Under the Moon, but the same kind of vibe in a way. This is like, you know, it's going to be all right. You're going to die. You're going to go to Juggalo heaven.
I actually found this track to be one of the more appealing ones.
I liked the chorus of this, to be honest. I thought it was kind of cool.
Yeah, the chorus sung once again by ICP friend Legs Diamond, and as well as samples of sermons from Christian televangelist and filmmaker Estes Perkel. Okay, so that pretty much just made Hallelujah fucking pointless then, didn't it?
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of redundancy on this record, but you know, I'm not going to fault him for that. It's a long record.
So just to circle back and get this out of the way, because I know we talked about it at the beginning where I was doing my Faygo count.
The final
Faygo count, ladies and gentlemen, Juggalos and Juggalettes, 7. 7 Faygo references throughout The Great Milenko.
That's it?
7 Faygo references.
I was expecting more.
So this track feels like a pretty nice bookend for the record, I feel like.
Yeah,
and
once again,
I'm surprised there wasn't going to be like one more dumbass skit at the end. I listened to it all the way at the end. I was like, oh, it just fades out. Interesting.
I mean, it fades out and then it just fades back in for some reason. But that's still a lot better than just doing another kind of penis thing.
Yeah, I'm gonna come back.
Look at my nuts.
Look at my nuts. Poo poo time. Yeah.
I once again have to give it up to Mikey Clark for the production. Like, I mean, it's not really the same kind of like hazy rap metal trip hoppy kind of fare that we've been hearing, but I feel like this is just a really solid 90s alt hip hop track that could just be reutilized by like Del the Funky Homo Sapien or The Far Side or something, and it would work just as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I would agree.
Yeah. I also got to give this song some extra credit for this line. I'm headed up to the show. I'm going to see Jimi Hendrix, Selena, and Eazy-E. Elvis tried to open up, but he got dissed off. We got pissed off because he sounded like butt.
Yeah.
How do you dislike that?
Yeah, sweet Elvis diss.
I mean, the first line in the song is pretty great, too. I got shot. Ah, the murder was heinous. The bullet went in my eyeball and out my anus.
Yeah, I mean,
I don't think those are connected, but okay.
He would have had to have been, like, levitating, like, flat on his stomach, and the bullet would have had to go, yeah, you know?
He would have had to have been just, like, flying forward like Raiden in Mortal Kombat.
Yeah.
No, if you were high enough, like, a few stories up, and you got, like, you shot downward, and you could kind of get an angle, like, through the eye that goes out the anus.
This seems like a lot of work just to shoot somebody.
Let's get some ballistics happening. I'll open up
somebody.
My lab.
Somebody call the fucking Mythbusters.
Yeah, I'll shoot some
today on Mythbusters. Can you shoot somebody in the eye and have it come out your anus?
Should we get to our final thoughts now?
Sure.
Okay. Do you think this is a worst of all time album, Patrick?
No. I mean, no, I've heard worse for what it is. I listened to this kind of solely not taking the lyrics into consideration and just kind of like listening to the production of it. And I've definitely heard way worse hip hop records. I've heard even like worse hip hop records with as good of production. It's stupid. I get why people didn't like Juggalos back in high school, and I remember why I didn't really like them that much. If you don't take it too seriously, it's 90s rap. It's what it is. It has its strong points. for sure.
Same question for you, Jim. Do you think this is a worst of all time record?
No, not at all. A lot of the same sentiments that Patrick had. The production's great. A lot of the beats are really cool. I didn't get bored at all listening to this album. I listened to it three times over the last 2 days, I think. And it's, I'm not going to lie, it's fucking entertaining. As stupid as some of the content is, I think they're self-aware of how silly it is, and they know perfectly well that it's fucking dumb and a gimmick, and I think they just went with it, and I think they did a good job. I mean, I know, I definitely don't think it's a worst of all time. I don't think it's something you're going to put on for Christmas Eve dinner, obviously, but... No, yeah,
they have a subculture, like, you know, that's definitely worth mentioning. Like,
well, that's the flip side. Like, it's not gonna this doesn't make me want to go out and fucking become a juggalo. But it's I felt like it was I'm not gonna go as far to say it's an enjoyable album, but I thought it was entertaining.
It clearly had an effect on some people. It's had more of an effect on like a larger amount of people than like. Other records that we've done on this show, like, you don't see a whole subculture devoted to calling all stations, do you?
Yeah, no. I mean, it's impressive. It's impressive if we're being serious. It is. It's impressive what the two of these dudes fucking did.
Yeah,
yeah.
They created a fucking religion.
Great marketing. Yeah. No, fucking great marketing.
Yeah.
As for me, I've primarily been on the outside looking in as far as Insane Clown Posse has gone. I knew maybe like three songs going into it, the infamous Miracles being one of them, and beyond those, I've never really made a concerted effort to check them out in greater detail. And now that I've sat through not just an ICP record, but an ICP record that's considered one of their greatest efforts, I don't dislike it. I can't in good conscience call it a good album, though, but I fully recognize that there's a good chunk of the music that is just bad by any sort of critical gauge, but at the same time, it's very difficult not to enjoy it for what it is, and the parts that do hit just hit very incredibly well. So yeah, I would say more than just reviewing The Great Milenko, though, that a major function of this episode was to attempt to get a better understanding of ICP themselves. And I definitely have a better respect for the group now that I've bothered to look beyond the memes and mockery, especially for Violent J, because he's shown in recent years to be quite forward-thinking on, like, modern social issues and has, like, gone back and apologized for some of the less well-aged material of years past.
Yeah. There's some shit in there.
I don't think I'm going to be checking them out any further, though. Like, when we released this app, when we announced this app, our friends at Make It Stop, who also reviewed an ICP record, warned us that after their episodes, they're basically convert juggalos now. And I regret to inform Heather and Mike that I will not be joining them at the next gathering. Sorry, but I wish them and all these rowdy axe lads and lasses all the best.
Oh, man, I would love to go to the gathering as, like, a social experiment. Yeah, no, I'll be behind the fucking bulletproof glass with Patrick. In my lab coat, and we'll just have our clipboard.
Oh, sure. Okay, sure. I'll check it out that way.
Very, very interesting. Look at what this one is doing. I have a great gift from the gathering. I'll send it to you guys.
But yeah, what would you say is the best or least bad track on this record, Pat?
So I'm actually going to go with the last track, Pass Me By. Is that what it's called?
Yeah, Pass Me By.
Yeah, it's... Like I said, I was judging this mostly on the music and the beats side of it because, like, you can't really... Sometimes the lyrics were too much on certain tracks and other times, like, you could kind of ignore the silliness of it. And that one in particular seemed the most genuine, I guess, for whatever that means in their world. And, yeah, the production was great. It was, like, kind of cool and hazy and had, like, a good melody to it. The piano stuff was pretty cool and like pretty slick, and I just kind of dug the arrangement of it. I like that they sort of like faded it back in at the end and didn't. It was a good way to kind of close out the record too. It wasn't like they didn't sort of pull in the cliche trick of like a closing juvenile skit. I kind of respected that, I guess.
Same question for you, Jim. What is the best or least bad track in your opinion?
I was also gonna go with "Pass Me By" because I just thought that beat was pretty cool. But to keep things spicy, I'm going to go with Boogie Woogie Woo, just because I, like I mentioned, I loved that female backing vocal. Just I thought that was a cool touch. And it was a fucking silly song. I mean, it's about the fucking boogeyman, for Christ's sake. But I was entertained and it made me laugh. And I liked those background vocals. So I'll go with Boogie Woogie Woo.
My favorite is House of Horrors. It is just too perfect for me.
Too spooky.
What would you say is the worst track, Patrick?
I'm going to go with the Needin' Game. That one just kind of got under my skin the most with the character that the person was trying to portray was just like didn't age well for me.
Mm. Same question for you, Jim. Worst track?
Patrick and I are on the same wavelength here. I'm going to go with that as well. I just think that's the... a lot of these songs on this album are silly and there's some questionable content, but this was the most cringeworthy song on the album, I would say. So yeah. I'm going to go with that one.
A lot of bra moments.
I mean, on this, we're all just kind of in the hand-holding club here because my worst track was also the Nedden Game. Like, who cares? Like, I mean, yeah, there was plenty of explicit content leading up to this, but this one I feel like just sort of plays around with it the most, like, just like Jim said, it's very cringy, and it just sort of plays around with it the most clunkily.
So that's it. That's the Milenko.
That's good, bad, the great Milenko.
I just want everybody to know I finished my Fago.
Oh, and in the spirit of fairness, then I'm going to try another sip of mine to see if it tastes any better.
Chug.
I will. No, I'm taking a sip.
Chug.
No, taking a tasteful sip.
Ugh, it's so much worse when it's warm.
Oh, I thought I kind of liked it.
I finished it.
I guess I really am. All this time, deep in my bones, I've been a juggalo.
You're gone. He's gone the way of the clown.
That's it. I'm going to clown college.
you people have stood in my way long enough. Thank you for coming back on the program, Jim.
Always a good
plug
time.
Plug something. What have you got to plug?
Not too much. The studio is up and running. If you've been listening to the old Men Yell at Cloud show on the Zero Science Network, you would know that I have completed the arduous task of building another fucking studio. It's taken me over a year. I'm going to be spinning up some websites with hopefully in the next couple of weeks, one being a personal website where I will showcase some of my drumming and mixing services. So look out for that.
Your personal journey as a juggalo.
Yeah, my personal journey as a juggalo. I'm going to have multiple web addresses. I haven't decided on what's going to be the main one, but I'm just going to have a lot of redirects, I think. So I've got jimschultzdrums.com, metadrummer.com, drumsmart.com. You go to any one of those, and you'll probably land on my page.
JimSchultzTrumpetPlayer.com.
Yeah, I also play the trumpet, in case you guys didn't know.
JimSchultzForSenate.com. Mm-hmm.
Dr. Jim for Senate.com. Dr. Jim Wrighton.
Dear Jim.
Oh, yeah.
JimMIT.com.
No, that's JimMIT.io.
Oh, of course.
Yeah.
What about you, Pat? You want to plug anything?
Yeah, I got an album coming out next month.
Nice.
December 18th, actually. Friday, December 18th. I'm dropping the record. There's going to be another announcement for a single somewhat before that. I think probably like for the week before. I haven't decided yet, but the official release date is December 18th. It actually features a couple of tracks from Jim playing drums.
Woo!
And all sorts of other peeps. So this will be my first record under the name Patrick S. Barry. The name of the record is 20-20, shorthand for 2020. That's coming out next month. And as soon as that's done, I'm probably going to start picking up some of the other podcasts again, like the Must Watch Movies. Got some episodes coming up in the near future starring Scott Kirkland.
Your much vaunted arc on discography deep dive.
Yep, got a discog deep dive coming up pretty soon too. Probably sometime in January, and should have some exciting podcast news post January too. Once I'm done with this album nonsense.
Nice. The fuzz rock band that I drum in, Surprise Party, we've been very slowly working on, like, recording some rough stuff that we're probably going to put out as singles.
Nice.
So that may be coming up on the horizon. But otherwise, I'll just plug, check out the other Zero Science podcasts. Old Men Yell at Cloud, Clamshell Case Files, Must Watch Movies, Hell is a Musical, Sophomore Slumps, World of Commotion, the whole deal.
Oh, I'll plug one more thing. Check out Cact Attack. That is my home bass band at this point. I joined that band at the beginning of the year, and then we had a pandemic. So I really haven't done much with them other than practice, but we were supposed to start recording our new album in December, but because of pandemic nonsense, we decided it's probably more responsible to push that out. But in the meantime, check out the other records that they've put out that I have mixed and produced. Mm.
Very nice. Our theme song is Sunny Day by the band Froggy and the Friendship. You can check them out at froggyandthefriendship.bandcamp.com. If you have an album you want to suggest for us to review or just would like to leave us some feedback or a comment, email us at jukeboxzerospodcast@gmail.com. You can also find us on Facebook at facebook.com/jukeboxzerospodcast or on Twitter at twitter.com/jukeboxzeros. You can find us, rate us, review us, and subscribe to us on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, Amazon Music, or just check out our archives on the Zero Science main page. Jukebox Zeroes is a production of the Zero Science Network. For more great podcasts, go check out zero-science.com. That about does it for this episode of Jukebox Zeroes. I'm Lilz.
And I'm Patrick.
And I'm the Great Milenko.
And remember.
Good night.
Bye-bye.
Zero Science.